Our next speaker is Dr. Dayakar Yadlaw, who would deal on the other relevant issue, enucleation. Dr. Dayakar is a medical consultant, Orbit Oculoplasty and Ocular Oncology Services at the Arvind Eye Care Services based in Pondicherry. So let's hear from you.
Thank you, madam. Good evening. Thank you, AAOS, and thank you, Chitra, madam, for giving me this opportunity. Got finding trouble with my slides. Yeah, in the introduction, so this is one of the most difficult therapeutic decision to choose in enucleation. So before you choose the decision, like take into the account of a patient's psychological makeup. So your tone of voice, your body language, how you are going to break the bad news, it all makes difference. In the visual potential of the eye, is there any vision the patient is going to get? That's what the most of the time they expect. They expect that once you remove the eye, we are going to place an artificial eye, and then they'll get back the vision. So we should tell like clearly that they're not going to get back the vision. So we're going to improve the cosmesis. That's what we explain. And then we have to discuss about the potential complications, intraoperative and postoperative. So always better to know about the history, because like what our ancestors has done, we should not repeat the same mistakes again. So this procedure is one of the most oldest procedure in ophthalmology, dated back to 2600 BC. Then there are Chinese gods dedicated in ocularist. 1555 is the latest documentation, which shows there is a traction suture passing through the eyeball, to pull the eyeball, so to do the enucleation. And then in 1840, in Dublin and Paris, they have documented the procedure. After the invention of 1846, general anesthesia invention, the whole scenario of the enucleation is changed. The main aim of the procedure is to remove the diseased tissue and improve the patient comfort. So the most of the time patient comes and says like, doctor, please remove the eye. Please give me comfort. I'm not able to sleep. I feel like committing suicide. So we give the comfort to the patient and replace the orbital volume with the implants, which my subsequent speakers are going to talk. Now the good functional cosmetic result of the patient, motility and the cosmesis is able to provide. So that is the main aim of the procedure. If you go to the indications, most of the textbooks says the malignancy is the indication, but in our setup, trauma is the most common indication, especially the drink driving. They'll drunk and then they're driving in the two-wheeler, fall down and come like this. This is not uncommon. Then the intraocular malignancies, it's always difficult, especially in children. In textbook says like choroidal melanoma, but in our setup we see most common in retinoblastomas, especially children, anxious parents, precious child, like difficult to convince them how to manage all that. Our experts are there, retinoblastoma, especially Dr. Santosh Anover, Dr. Usha Madam are going to talk. Then the most common in the exam, they'll ask you, what is the most common for enucleation is the cadaveric. That's what we should tell in the exams. And then the next is the painful blind eye. This is the painful blind eye. We said like, we'll give them a steroids and then the atropine ointment and send them. This is one of our patients who came with the atropine allergy, full diffuse redness and diffuse pain. The patient is begging, please remove my eye. So that's what it comes like. Then the indications for tumor, the most common intraocular malignancies. So intraocular malignancy, as I was talking, retinoblastomas, next is the choroidal melanoma. So, but now the enucleation has become a rare with retinoblastoma because of the invention of intra-arterial chemotherapies, intravenous chemotherapy and radiotherapy. And the eyes always procedure and the vision always procedures are there. The next subsequent speakers will talk about it. Choroidal melanoma also enucleation is rare if you identify early. There are a lot of debate, like after enucleation, chance of metastasis is more because of the seedling, tumor seedling. And then the enucleation when you're doing, go for a no touch technique, and there are a popular video by Santosh Anover, the myoconjunctival technique of implant placement that shows exactly the no touch technique. And any other neoplasms are the indications for enucleation. The trauma and the primary, in the trauma we can divide into primary enucleation and secondary enucleation. The primary enucleation, the affected eye has a no light perception. Please check the light perception with the indirect ophthalmoscopy. Don't check the other normal torch lights. then the pupillary response should be absent. An extensive corneal scleral laceration, which has a posterior margin extending beyond the ora serrata, where we are not able to visualize the posterior extent, and you have a setup where you have a frozen section which can document the collapsed uvea or retina in the wound. That's the perfect evidence for medical legal cases. The fellow eye should be normal. The patient should be alert and cooperative. That is the most difficult part, because the patient, most of them, they'll be drunk or a drug abuse. The patient or a guardian understand that removal of traumatized eye precludes the return of vision. That is the most important. Next is the indications in the trauma, secondary enucleation. So otherwise called sympathetic ophthalmia. This is the relative contraindication. To recap, the injured eye is called the exciting eye. The normal eye is called the sympathizing eye. The most of the time, sympathizing eye will have a less vision. The exciting eye will have a better vision. It's very difficult to go for an enucleation in an exciting eye. The incidence of sympathetic ophthalmia is like 1 in 1,000 to 2 in 100 in traumatized eyes. In the Massachusetts Eye and Ear Infirmary has confirmed that 65% of cases occurred in 2 weeks to 3 months time. So enucleation, if at all you are planning to do, go for a less than 2 weeks time to prevent the sympathetic ophthalmitis. This is one of our patients who had a fall from the two-wheeler drunk driving, then came like somewhere they've done a evisceration, but the copious discharge of pus. So we're not sure what is happening. Always go for imaging, rule out foreign body. This is a foreign body, wooden foreign bodies, especially wooden foreign bodies, is difficult to identify in immediate post-op. So it'll take 2 to 3 weeks to get an air shadow, then look for air shadow and try to remove that. Otherwise, it's not going to help. Other indications are painful blind eye, and then the cosmesis. The neovascular glaucoma, after the invention of the intravitreal Avastin injections, the neovascular glaucoma managing is better. Enucleation is come down. Then uveitis or endophthalmitis, as my previous speaker was talking. And then there's a cosmesis, especially the young girls, like their psychological appearance, behavior, everything changes. You can see in this picture. So there is a very rare, I read only in textbook, like autoenucleation is called Oedipism, where the patient himself removes psychological disturbance, removes their eye and resect and comes. The contraindications, and then any malignancy which spread to the orbit. So it is always better to not to do the enucleation and rule out the systemic spread. Then the sympathetic ophthalmitis, already established sympathetic ophthalmitis is a relative contraindication. In the poor general condition, patient is bedridden, patient is going to die, like there is no point to doing more harm, more pain to the patient. And similarly, psychological disturbance where they cannot give a consent. Written consent is the most important part. So if they're not able to give a consent, then better not go ahead with it. The enucleation surgery, always go for a pre-operative evaluation. Make sure that you thorough evaluation. Get an informed written consent clearly.
Doctor, 1 minute.
Okay, I'll click. Then always general anesthesia. Do one general anesthesia with retrobulbar block, because it causes the ocular cardiac reflex. To prevent the ocular cardiac reflex, do a retrobulbar block. Then the medical problems, especially the anticoagulants and the bleeding, should be evaluated before. This is my video. For a time, lack of time, I'm skipping the video. Then the complications are divided into intraoperative, postoperative, and early and late complications. Intraoperative complications, removal of the wrong eye. This is the worst nightmare any person, any professional can have. Nobody can save you if you do the wrong eye enucleation. The loss of rectus muscle, you can retrieve it. Hemorrhage, usually you do the thorough cautery, especially anticoagulants. Then do a pressure bandage for 24 to 48 hours, but you can go up to 5 to 7 days if the bleeding is more. Late postoperative, like a lax socket, and then the post-enucleation socket syndrome, and then dry socket when there is a damage to the lacrimal apparatus, lacrimal gland. Discharge when there is a granulomas tissue, difficulty in retaining the prosthesis, like anophthalmos due to fat atrophy. Pain is the worst in the pain. This post-operative pain, they say like I may commit suicide. Normal analysis will not work. Go for a tricyclic antidepressants. So that is a painkiller. So you should use it. Cosmesis is the one we always address before. Always invest on your ocularist. They will make your life easier.
Okay, thanks, sir.
It's done. Finished. Thank you. This is one of our happiest patients. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Doctor. Dr. Santosh, I have a question here. How do you ensure that the eye movements are retained as we are going to be disinserting the extraocular muscles in this case?
Well, there are many ways of doing it. One of which is you suture the muscles back to just close to the fornices. That's called myoconjunctival technique. The second one is to use integrated implants. Integrated implants are biointegrated implants, which are hydroxyapatite or porous polyethylene, which get integrated with the orbital soft tissues to which the muscles, of course, will be attached. And that improves mobility depending on whether you kind of drill the implant or not. So the procedure is that you put in an implant first, and after it vascularizes, drill and peg the implant. And to the peg, the prosthesis gets indirectly attached. So that will ensure the best of movements.
Supposing the implant was not placed in the primary setting, so how do we go about it, sir?
You can do a secondary implant. If the surface is adequate, then secondary implant is the treatment of choice. Suppose surface is also compromised, suppose you have both volume loss as well as surface loss, then a dermis fat graft would be more appropriate.
Thank you, sir.